Turn to the no bullshit hour.
What is Karen doing? She's sitting in that damn car. She's sitting in the car like Red sits in the car. And when Red, I don't even know where Red's at.
No one knows.
But look, I bet you this internet's gonna fuck up. You know what we should have her do?
Come
just,
here.
Just go to White Castle and keep driving around ordering. Just that's what she could do all show long. Send it to Arby's because that's real sirloin. She's not going to eat that.
Assistant breaking news. Dub or bullshit? Dub or bullshit?
No bullshit.
Jeez. Okay, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. Every Friday I get worked up. I want to be funny, but I can't be funny because it's not funny. Told you.
Yeah.
Listen, look, I know friends, wives of friends, and then the friends don't watch, but the wives, well, hi, everybody. Told you, this wasn't a storm of the century that submerged. It's not even a century. It's 1,000 years, they said.
Yeah.
1,500 years.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus is coming back next time.
It's only been the
fifth wasn't
time.
The storm of a century. It was failure by those dummies downtown that jack your water bills up, give contracts to their friends, and you lose and lose and lose. We told you. My smart friends, the hydrologists, the engineers, the contractors, you believed it. The reason you're here, the reason I walked from the mainstream media is they won't do it. In fact, they rip us off. There's that one too. We'll get into that. So who we'll have today is Paul Daugherty, who is suing. Oh, we're going to find out he's suing. He's going to sue everybody.
Everyone. Yeah.
For the people of Detroit that got fucked.
Finally.
Again.
Maybe someone's going to have to pay for a lie.
Yeah, let's do it like this. It is astonishing that the capital E establishment, this is from a friend, emailed this, so I'm plagiarizing, so I'm giving good credit. I can't write it better. The establishment jefes get away with it. After Whitmer and Duggan lied to the city and state, lied to every newsroom, lied to President Biden, trafficking that 2,000-year storm bullshit lie in Washington Post, op-eds, etc. They lie to FEMA and lock up the federal aid for global warming flooding. It finally trickles out. The back-to-back flooding, 2014-2021, was pure Great Lakes Water Authority bureaucrat cesspool incompetence. And that is a fact. Okay, so we got Paul Daugherty here. Mm-hmm. Also, we need to do some culture. So we have Satori Shakur here. Hey. It is the 50-year anniversary of... is it Parliament? Is it Parliament Funkadelic? Is it Funkadelic? It's that whole George Clinton scene, Satori Shakur, formerly Jeanette Magruder, you know, the Bride of Funkenstein. You guys remember that?
I love it.
That was the hippest shit in the world.
Very cool.
That disappeared. So she's here to talk about those days. I was watching, you know, on Amazon Prime,
mm-hmm.
Blow the Roof Off, the true story.
Oh, yeah, documentary.
Yeah, mm-hmm. P-Funk, and it was actually the true story. So she's here to talk about that, talk about herself, talk about... whatever she wants to talk about, look at her.
She's
look,
a good. She's a good talker. Beautiful woman.
You know, well, that's disgusting by you.
What?
How dare you notice that?
I said
that?
Good talker first.
Okay. Karen's a beautiful woman.
You also should check out Mike Judge's Tales from the Tour Bus.
Okay. Oh, yes. Yes. I have not seen the Parliament episode, but I've seen that show. It's great. Yes.
That is... keep that little funk rhythm going there.
I got to find it.
What's
but, yeah.
going on?
That's crazy.
Stop me right in the middle of the funky. So if we'll get into what P-Funk is, but basically, it's seminal. That is just one of, if you listen to hip-hop, you listen to Dr. Dre, you know who P-Funk is, and that's a Detroit thing. And she still lives here.
Good.
So we'll get into that, too. I mean, I'm tired of all of us being down. Right? Then we got the news. Kwame got married. Spivey got indicted. The coward cops got taken off the street. The House Oversight Committee in Washington
yeah.
is looking into Flint and them destroying evidence, the Snyder administration. Not a word from Nestle here in Michigan. Goddamn bullshit. Oh, and the Taliban.
What?
They got the borders now.
Oh, great.
They're starting to cut heads off and burn homes of people that worked with the Americans. Like, and we can't get them out. right? And finally, Red, Detroit comedian, Detroit Red, we sent him out to talk to the Trumpies. Got a little tease.
Believe it or not, the Trump train is still rolling. And so is the Trump Unity Bridge float right along with it.
So Red has embedded with the Trump Unity people. I haven't seen it. I hope it's good. All right, look, before we get to it, as always, the No Bullshit News Hour brought to you by American Coney Island, Troy's oldest family-owned restaurant and the birthplace of the Coney Dog.
Yeah.
The roof has been done. The air conditioning's solid.
Who did all that?
I helped. But it's because it's a damn delicious dog right there on the corner of Michigan and Lafayette, and right there in the middle of Detroit. The epicenter is being held down by a woman. That is no small feat. So, please, patronize. It's clean. They got the sanitizers. There's room for the kids to sit. They got chicken strips. Who got chicken strips? Lafayette got chicken strips?
No.
No, they didn't got no chicken strips. So, listen, if you want a Coney kit, dozen dogs right to your door with the chili and all the fixings, go to AmericaConeyIsland.com. Again, we do this ADR.
Yeah.
ADR Associates. Listen, Paul, listen to me. You want what ADR does, Paul? They do it all. They do zoning. They do construction, deconstruction, demolition, rehab, property management, big jobs, little jobs. The water department should hire this fucking guy. But they don't.
But Charlie, are they honest?
They're not honest. They're not ethical. They're not smart. But Barry Ellentuck is at ADR. Give him a call for a free consultation. 248-318-9424. Again, Amanda, you called. Does he help with evictions, etc.? He does. Call him. See if he can help you. Listen, 248-318-9424. And give me this, because the Bride of Funkenstein, listen to this one. Listen to this lay down here. This is Maurice Davis.
Ah, yes.
Mark! Yeah. That's Maurice Davis, king of the party blues, and Flint City Councilman, Ward number 2.
When it comes to securities,
when it comes to securities and investment, who are you gonna call? Luke Nowacki, Pinnacle Wealth.
They're making finance funky.
Royal Alliance and Associate Incorporated.
248-663-4748.
They specialize in securities.
They do rational financial advice in those securities.
They're the best in the business.
Sure are.
All of your investment needs. Look here.
That's right, stocks.
Wall is the one.
Bonds.
You want to call.
College savings plan. Who are you going to call? 248.
So pick up the phone today.
663-478.
And call the one and only. Wall Alliance and Associates.
And you're asking for Luke Nowacki. Thank you very much, and thank you. Hard cut. All right.
Woo.
Okay.
A lot to get to.
Paul Daugherty, water lawyer. Paul, what are you doing? You are suing on behalf of Grosse Pointe Park people?
Well, that, and we've got a separate lawsuit for City of Detroit.
Well, who's doing City of Detroit?
Say it again?
Who's doing the City of Detroit?
I am.
You're the man. Who's doing Grosse Pointe Park?
I am.
Oh, you're doing both?
I'm doing both.
Separately?
Separately.
Why?
Well, I think Detroit has unique issues, unique problems. It's a unique area. There have been made many, many, many empty promises over the years about fixes, about recovery, about revitalization. And I can tell you, Jefferson Chalmers hasn't seen any of that. So I wanted something separate and special for them. I had a call from a woman today that lives down there and said, you know what? The last time we had this happen and we hired whatever law firm to do it, I got 3 months of my water bill knocked off. And she said, I don't want to see that again. I said, well, don't worry. That's not the way we roll. So they've got some big issues down there. They don't have the resources, no insurance, et cetera. So Great Lakes Water's got to pay for what they did down there.
Okay. I mean, I could just go nuts. But look here.
Amen.
Once Great Lakes Water pays, that means I'm paying. I'm Great Lakes Water. Like, Karen, what's your water bill this month? By the way, she flooded.
You know, Charlie, I did what?
Your basement flooded. So, but you know, how much you get charged for
well,
that?
Well, yeah, it was $600, and they said we used 32,000 gallons of water. That was for the last month. So I don't.
You got
think
a fucking pet giraffe,
and I'm not. quite sure that happened.
You see this? I told you shit was going to fuck up.
I know.
That's you, Charlie. That's not me.
Hey, white guy, internet dude over there.
He's shaking his head now.
It's not us. No. Okay. So, Paul, here's the news. We've been saying it. Look, global warming exists. I'm sorry, y'all. Get in there, man. Challenge me. There ain't no global warming. I'll tell you how you know there's global warming. Put your car in the garage, close the door, turn it on, and feel how hot it starts to get. What you think? Like all this gas from your car goes into outer space? It doesn't. It's getting warm. Sure. But this wasn't it, Paul, was it? What did we find out this week, Paul?
Well, we found out some very important and damning issues about Great Lakes Water Authority. The first one was that, well, let me just back up. You got Freud pumping. Those are the two main stations that take care of the east side of Detroit into the Grosse Pointe on up into Macomb County. So Connor Creek, when it reaches capacity, it pumps over to Freud. 2 days before the flood, a private contractor severed a cable line at Freud, causing power to eight pumps or five of the eight pumps to go out. According to Sue McCoy, now former CEO of Great Lakes Water, the board was not, quote unquote, made aware of that problem. So,
let me make sure this is clear. Listen to me. Yeah. One big pumping station pumps into another pumping station.
When they reach capacity.
The second pumping station didn't have any power for 2 days before the rains that they knew were coming. And the geniuses at the top said they weren't aware.
Correct.
Okay. And then
I think that's part of why Sue McCormick was shown the door. She should have been aware, and the board should have been aware.
It seems to me we're starting to hear they were aware, very possibly. And if you weren't, you're out of here. Now, the other plant that was supposed to pump into it, Connor Creek, its pumps went out. Why? One of them blew a gasket and sprayed water on the electric board of the other ones. And that one went out.
Oh, man.
And there was no electrician there to fix it. Right, Paul?
Exactly. Well, the electrician went over to Freud. He left Connor Creek, went to Freud.
Looked down the hole, said, there's no power.
You know, then now he's called back to Connor Creek. But by then, the streets had flooded around Connor Creek, so he couldn't get back into Connor Creek. And when he finally got back there, the key card reader for the gate was out because the power was out. So if you've ever seen the Three Stooges, the way they used to work, you know, you'd run around, he'd hit each other on the head.
Yeah.
That's kind of what I was picturing out in front of the Connor Creek pumping station.
So
now,
Paul, just FYI, in Detroit, we call it Frood. We know the proper term is Freud, but we refer to it as Frood. That's how we call the street.
I do hear it pronounced Frood.
I'm just letting you know. So if you're representing Detroit, they know you really know what's going on. So go ahead.
That's Karen. She lives just off of Gratuit.
Gratuit. Paul, there's a lot of finger pointing going back and forth, but one of the interesting things I thought from my perspective was that GLEWA, I believe it was, said, oh, no, we knew, but these guys did not report it to the higher ups. Do you buy that at all? I feel like they're throwing the people that work in the actual pumping station under the bus.
Can't wait to get their depositions. The regular everyday Joe's working at the station and the guys that are, you know, filling out logs. I mean, they don't know because they don't want to know, apparently. I mean, these are basics of how these stations keep operating. You know, you picture a fort and you've got, you know, 16 guards on top. And, you know, most of the year nobody tries to get in the fort, but every now and then somebody tries to get in and you've got to have all 16 ready to go. Well, that's what these stations do. They sit dormant. A day like today, none of these pumps are running. They don't have to run. They only have to run when the weather's bad. And then they have to run full tilt and they have to come online on time. I mean, Connor Creek, it's not just the pumps don't work. They have to be primed, and I won't bore you with the technical details, but they've got eight massive pumps 30 feet in the ground that have to draw water up to start. And why they have to draw water up, won't bore you, but it really is a function of the changes in the sewer system from the 70s. They drop the water levels, and meaning these pumps are not going to start when you want them to start like you start a car. They have to be prepared. And that gets to knowing what the weather is. And Sue McCormick, during one of her press conferences, says an inch and a half of rain was predicted. Well, Sue McCormick and the other GLEWA people don't have to watch the local news to figure out what the weather's going to be. There are rain stations throughout the city and measuring devices. They're in the west and south, so they can see an hour before the rain gets to this area how much rain is falling. So they know damn well what's coming, and this idea that wasn't predicted is BS.
Well, first of all, it's like, throw all that away, it's bullshit. The fucking pumping station didn't have power to it. Didn't matter if it was going to be 1,000 feet of rain, it wasn't going to work. And you didn't know. And by the way, before it became the Great Lakes Water Authority, ladies and gentlemen, it was the Detroit Water and Sewerage Department that ran everything. She was running it in 2014, the last time Conner Creek fucked up and didn't pump. Was she gone? No. You want to know why she wasn't gone? You want to trust LeDuff, who've been looking at this cesspool for a dozen years now? Because ask Kwame Kilpatrick. All the money's in the contracts in the water department, and it's best to have cronies at the top doing what you tell them to do so you can pass out shit to your friends. Is that right, Paul?
You know, GLEWA,
no bullshit, Paul. Speak the truth.
Pardon?
Speak the truth. No hemming and hawing.
They've taken $500 million a year. The water department was one of the crown jewels of the city of Detroit, all right? So you have to ask yourself, why in 2014 would the city give away that crown jewel to GLEWA? How was GLEWA allowed to take it over? Well, one way was that the city of Detroit now receives $50 million a year in lease payments from GLEWA. City of Detroit can cut its staff from 1,500 down to between 250 and 500. So you've got basically the same net revenue, but you don't have to operate anything anymore. But our water system is one of the best in the world as far as delivering clean water and is very profitable. So there's a lot of money being put in and out of that system every year. So hence, the people controlling it have their hands on some pretty big purse strings.
So what did he just say there? Mark, what did he just say?
They make a lot of money.
Fuck yeah, it's a cesspool, man.
They make a ton of money.
Hey, Gross Point Park.
Don't put anything back into it.
How you like that now? Oh, but everybody's water bill is going up.
Yeah, of course.
Is FEMA going to cut checks, Paul, now knowing this isn't a natural disaster?
I don't know if anybody's gotten one. I've had a lot of people say they denied me. I'm doing an appeal, but nobody's gotten anything. They should be below altar. And Jefferson Chalmers, that's where they should start.
Karen, you're muted, goddammit.
Poor Karen. She finally gets to leave her house. Oh, she trouble. Finally. No.
I'm muted, Karen.
There okay, you. Can you hear me now? I'm yes, saying that the fine. People I've talked to have, they're being offered small business loans. That's what FEMA is denying their application and instead offering them small business loans. But I thought the whole purpose of the Great Lakes, well, not the entire purpose, but part of the purpose of the Great Lakes Water Authority was because the city was unprepared or not able to respond or to address the known infrastructure issues. And this was supposed to help circumvent that. The same thing with the other assets that we let go. But yet and still, that didn't happen.
Satori, did you get flooded? You live in Detroit.
I did not. I live in North Rosedale Park. I did not get flooded. I have been flooded before, but not this time, thankfully. My sister who lives up the road in Southfield, she was power out for 3 days. And it's a lot of wreckage over there, tree branches, trees, it's bad.
Look, folks, we've all been around the world here. I've never seen infrastructure, you know, like basic human services, power and water go out like this. Not in Tijuana, not in Mexico City, not in Brazil, not in Russia. When do we had enough? When are the media going to get off the ass and stop going into the press conferences and printing it as it dribbles out every day? It starts to change. Like, you don't have some kind of blame in this. You know, it's now in there. Everybody thinks this was a Noah flood.
Paul, I find it really interesting that DTE is, like, very insistent and pointing finger and said, we knew that power was out and you did nothing about it. How do they fit into the lawsuit that you have?
Well, Mark, here's the deal. There is a power station right near Freud or
Frood.
Frood.
Beef oven.
And that power station is apparently still controlled by the Detroit Power and Lighting Company.
Okay, now watch.
Yeah.
Watch this.
It gets confusing.
This was back in the bankruptcy. I did a story about the Detroit Power and Lighting, right? And they turned on the streetlights with the Frankenstein switch. Yeah. And we filmed that and the streetlights at the same time, and it didn't go on. Now, it looks like a nuclear bomb went off there, a neutron bomb, right? The stuff's still there. There's nobody in there. Everything's from the 50s. There's four people left in the Detroit Water or Lighting and Power.
Power, yeah.
Four people.
The whole department?
The whole department. Hmm. And they're in charge of the electricity to the major pumping station? Well, hello?
Yeah. Well, there's a switchover from DT that is taking 10 years. I don't know why. I mean, I don't know why.
Knuckleheads downtown. Yeah. You feel me? Everybody listen. Tell your husband. Tell your child. Knuckleheads downtown. This should be done. It's not done. You're fucking fired. And it shouldn't just start with, Sue McCormick. I'm going to resign. I was thinking of doing this, but, out of very much a service to my community, I decided to stay on through the COVID.
What a hero.
No. You got fired. Mike Duggan fired you. Mike Duggan has four of the six votes. This is on Mike Duggan, the mayor of Detroit. Hold his feet to the fire. Are you afraid? Paul?
No. We're doing it right now. I mean, we've got it going, and they're going to, this is a potential $100 million damage situation caused by this flood. All right, that's big dough. And GLIWA apparently self-insured. We're going to find out exactly what they've got.
Wait, yeah. Big. Let's do this again, everybody. Our water authority self-insured. Karen pays $600 a month for water she doesn't even use. You get to pay for it. Remember how they killed in Flint? Mm. You get to pay for it. So, Paul, I'm glad you're going to do it because FEMA's not going to give a shit. We're basically going to have to pay for all the idiots that you keep voting for and telling me he's great. I can't go to cocktail parties anymore. Satori, I can't because people think I'm a nut. Well, no, that was a 1,000-year flood. That's bullshit. Who was here to measure that? The Algonquins? They're doing that with a wild rice planter?
Charlie, what was the whole press thing with the governor now saying they're giving $10 million to who for what and how?
Oh.
I mean, what was that? Or was that just a...
Here we go, folks.
What was that?
It's a bridge until we get this all worked out, like the unemployment and everything. We have a bridge fund of $10 million. Just apply to it and not get that either. But 10 just to get you through. That's the same amount of money she raised last year, and that's probably not legal. $10 million?
Yeah, that's an insult. What are you doing with that? Spread over all the counties that were impacted. It's not just for Detroit. It's for, everybody that was affected by the flood. So
4 million people.
That's a pretty thin spread.
4 million people. Yep. 40% of the fresh water comes from this system, and this is what we got. Paul, I'm going to give you the last word.
Well, the water department's great at delivering fresh water to us, but they're not so good taking the shit away from your property and not storing it in your basement until they can deal with it. That's the problem. They've regularly used basements of Gross Pointers, Detroiters, on down to the Conner plant as storage tanks for raw sewage until they can figure out what to do with it. And it's based on the fact that they can't get 16 pumps going when they need to. Very simple. You get 16 running and we got a flood. Well, you did the best you could. You get 7 running, maybe 8 by 2:15 a.m. and we have massive flooding. Everybody's got a problem with that. They're going to pay for it.
And Paul, you flooded too, right?
Oh, only 8 feet in the basement. I was only 8 feet of water. Literally, I opened up my basement door, looked down, and was up to the last step. It was a surreal moment. I'm like, what am I looking at here? What kind of failure did I have in my house? I thought a water line broke or something, and it was 8 feet of brown water. I mean, my basement is gutted, everything gone. Furnace, no hot water tank, no washer, no dryer, all the walls, all the mementos, everything.
Now,
wiped out.
I'm just stating the obvious. I just, I know demographics and whatnot. You You don't live on Cadieux over. You're not on Iroquois. You're probably over there in the Coast Point Park.
Yeah, correct.
Okay.
I'm going to take care of it.
Okay, look at it.
But Paul, think about the people who were impacted equally or more severely, who don't have the resources to take care of it, and that are asked to be that are extended the courtesy of being reimbursed when they didn't have the resources to make up for the furnace or the water heater and all of the items that they lost, including personal items that can't be documented or replaced.
That's why we have a special claim for Detroiters. That's why we've segregated out their claims. They don't need to be tied into Grosse Pointe or people that have insurance or people that have money. They need to be treated separately because it's a special circumstance.
What are you, Jim Crow? What do you mean? Am I here?
That didn't sound right.
Segregated and treated separately?
Their claims have to be viewed independent of the others.
That means somebody got to fight for people that don't have the money to have a voice.
Exactly. Yeah,
right on, brother. Now, look, I made a joke there, but let me bring it together. A well-to-do white man who is also affected understands that the not-so-well-to-do black woman is also affected. This is what is good. This is what's powerful. It's too bad it has to be in something like this, but it's appreciated. If somebody got to help. We're all humans. Mm-hmm.
That's what we're trying to do, Charlie. I mean, let me just read you one sentence from the complaint I filed for the Detroiters. Quote, for many of the proposed class, they lack resources to do proper and thorough sanitizing and cleaning after a backup event and are consequently forced to live in homes which the smell of raw sewage and mold lingers until the next backup and pose related health risks to those living in such tainted homes. I mean, there are people I get calls from Detroit that still haven't been able to clean their basements out.
Wow.
And that's raw sewage, mold is growing. It's a terrible health risk.
Are you accepting clients? It's not class action lawsuit at this point, but are you accepting clients?
We are. Yeah, we've probably got 500 as it is. And
give them your number.
Coming in daily.
Give them your number. Put it out there right now.
It's 1-855-VEN-FIGHTS, V-E-N FIGHTS. I'm with the Venn Johnson Law Firm in Detroit.
So 1-855-VEN-FIGHTS.
Right.
That's too many numbers.
Well, you get to the end, it doesn't matter.
Oh, so you're just dialing out like I'm some kind of idiot. Okay. I went to public school, but I know something's up.
Pushing buttons.
He's padding the bill already. No, listen, Paul, thank you, brother. Godspeed. Let's keep in touch. And remember, everybody, fight on.
Yeah.
You're the boss. Don't fall apart. Come together. We don't need this.
Especially when you're lied to. Over.
And over.
And over. And over again.
Right on. Okay, Paul, thanks. If you want to hang for the rest of the show, you may.
You appreciate it, bro. Thank you. Okay. Bye-bye, everybody.
Thanks,
Paul.
You
don't want to hang
bye-bye
for the rest of the show.
He's got people to sue.
Okay.
So, Charlie, we don't want this to turn into the Flint issue where you've got a lot of people and they may do a great job, and at the end of the day, everybody gets $5 and nothing ever changes. It's not the goal.
How much you want to bet that's what happens? Because that's what happened last time. We won't.
Yeah.
Not to my last.
That's what I'm saying. So this sounds good, but at the end of the day, will the people who need to? And I understand Paul's heart's in the right place. I applaud the fact that he's taking that initiative because there aren't people that are helping the people that need help. But I don't want to hear things like segregated. That's not. I mean, that's a very touchy thing between Detroit and Grosse Pointe. And everybody in Detroit isn't struggling, although there are people that could certainly benefit from his help. I just don't want to group everybody
that's
in.
That's why I was making light of it. Like, you know what I mean? That's why I was making light of it, because it's trigger language. But I don't think he means it that way.
I don't think he does either. But people that don't think like that say things like that, and then it can become offensive, and then it's counterproductive.
That's why we talk about it as it happens. If that's what you're about, then that's what you're about.
However it winds up, I just hope it's punitive enough, because it's not about it's not only about what happened. It's I don't want this to happen again. And it is as often as it has happened. It's hard to believe that it's not just going to happen again, because nothing gets. No shit ever gets fixed.
And this isn't a clever transition, but I'm going to tell you about David Hall Mortgage.
Oh yeah.
If you want to get out,
a clever transition.
You're looking, maybe there's an opportunity, you believe they're going to fix it, you want to get in there, you call David Hall Mortgage. If you need to refinance to help yourself fix your basement because you don't have the insurance, you do that, you can save hundreds of dollars a month in your payment, you can skip a couple of payments. There's ways to help yourself, right? Call David Hall Mortgage. Take advantage of historically low interest rates. Go to DavidHallMortgage.com or call 248-308-5000. They're righteous people, right?
Yeah, they're good people.
All right, let's do some news before... well, Satori's already here, but let's just do some news real quick. Kwame Kilpatrick got married.
Oh, lovely.
That's wonderful. Last weekend, that's... terrific.
Beautiful bride.
It was a regular gangster's paradise. It was great. There was Bobby Ferguson, who just got out of the can. You know, the right hand, stealing from the water department. That's yeah. That's a conviction.
Kwame still owes about $1.5 million.
$1.5 million.
To the water department and then additional funds to the city.
So it's a nice wedding, but you got to pay the city back. Forget that. Remember, ambulances didn't show up for children. I'm just about, okay. And there was White Boy Rick. That's cool. He met the former mayor in the can. That's great. Come on to my wedding. You're going to be wonderful. He was looking tan and fit right there by the canopy.
Yeah.
Driving his white Mercedes. You know what I mean? Good luck. Good luck. Oh, I found out how he's got 3 children and 6 grandchildren.
How?
He had them all before he went to the can when he was 17.
Oh, wow.
Not the grandchildren, but the kids.
Yeah.
That was just a question.
Clearly.
Because I was wondering if he's getting conjugal.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
No, somebody please ask Rick. What sex is like in prison for 30 years. That's all I want to know at this point.
Hopefully non-existent.
You know what I mean?
Or solo.
How do you keep it
quiet? We're getting off track. We're getting off track.
Right. Oh, no, we're still at the wedding here. I mean, like, how do you rub one out when you got a bunkmate? I mean.
Quietly?
I mean.
Quickly?
I got questions. Okay.
Right, Karen?
I'm not listening to this.
And who else was there? Who else was at the wedding? Mike Duggan.
That blows my mind.
That's wonderful. That's not the only thing that gets blown.
I can't believe he was there.
His gal pal doctor was there. Remember
yeah,
the
there
one?
She's in the photo. Yeah.
Remember the one where he was like slipping preferential public money to her, and then his staff's deleting emails trying to cover it up, to which the attorney general says there's nothing wrong with that. It's perfect. Now I got a name for this couple. His honor and the doctor. His healer. His honor and his healer.
I'll take it.
So that's wonderful. They're there. Okay. I know Kilpatrick and Duggan go way back. Kilpatrick is a protege of Duggan's.
Yes.
But what are you doing at a wedding like this?
Charlie, I can't figure it out. I can't figure out who owes who what or why.
Rudy Giuliani used to be the U.S. attorney, took out the mob, right? Yep. Then he becomes the mayor of New York. Did he go to John Gotti Jr.'s 50-year birthday party?
No.
Mm-mm. No, even if you love the guy, like, you represent all of us.
Yeah.
That's what I think.
The optics were awkward, yep. Charlie. Awful. The optics were very awkward. They were.
Satori,
I didn't go.
I don't think they were awful. Were they awful?
I don't know whether the optics were awful or not, but I think that once you have served your time and paid for your crime, then you are released and you're free to get married. You're free to invite whom you want to your wedding.
Yes.
And if that includes Mayor Duggan and other people who are operatives of a faulty, flawed, and racist system, then, you know, so be it.
What about the optics from the other side? Why would Duggan go?
Hold on, guys. I want to clarify. I said the optics were awkward. I didn't say awful. I said awkward.
I think from Duggan's perspective, they're pretty awful.
I agree with everybody here. But I say they're all, you can have anybody you want. But here's one thing, just to rein off this. Mr. Kilpatrick, you can become a minister. That's wonderful. Wonderful. God. I'm Catholic. You know what we do when we sin?
Atone.
We must go to confession and say it out loud and apologize to the Lord and everybody we hurt. Our sin.
Yeah.
You can't be some minister still saying I didn't do nothing.
Yeah.
You didn't get pardoned. They just let you out.
Maybe apologize to God. Maybe he did that in private, Charlie.
Apologize
to us. Everybody's been asking for a public apology for him since day one. Maybe he's made... you know, I mean, we got to extend that courtesy. Maybe I'm not he extending has, if he shit. Come to terms with Jesus.
I'm not extending shit. You also owe me an apology. I got to apologize about everything. I know. I'm sorry, everybody. I love you. I know I'm a fuck up and a big mouth. I am. But I never did anything big and intentional to hurt people. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm a flawed person, but I'm trying. Please forgive me for all the dumb little shit I did.
You know, it doesn't matter whether you did it intentionally, inadvertently, unawares. If you know, as human beings, we're gonna hurt, bump into people and their ideas and their thoughts. You know, that's why I always say, listen, I know I'm gonna offend somebody when I open my mouth. You're not gonna agree with me, and that's fine. You know, so it's not I intentionally or I, you're going to do it because you're human. And, you know, I say, you know, that just a bunch of people out there that haven't apologized publicly and probably never will. And that's Trump and all his boys. You know what I mean? So, I mean, who has hurt whom the most? You know, we're talking about an insurrection at the Capitol. We're talking about inciting, you know, all of this. We're talking about coding the insurrection, calling it a tourist activity. So I, you know, I don't know. I mean,
we know that. Dude, that is bullshit.
I'm okay
too.
To talk about. I mean, I'm okay to listen to you talk about Kwame's wedding or whatever.
Yep.
But I like the idea of going to the root of things, because once you are part of the system, and Charlie, you say you have this show because you weren't allowed, you were going to be used by different journalistic outlets and you weren't able to speak about what you wanted to speak about.
Yeah.
So you had to come out, create your own platform to be fully expressed. But once you are absorbed into a big system, and all systems, like Neely Fuller said, are infected by white male supremacy, which systemic racism is a function of, then you're going to be used in the service of its perpetuation.
Yeah, I think, so, I think, you know, it's all of us, because there's nothing white about Kwame.
Everything you're talking about is a symptom of something larger. Unless you blow that shit up,
yeah,
then we're going to be trying to put band-aids.
I don't want to talk in phraseology. I'm looking at the people perpetuating, and that's all I could do. So, for instance,
no, but operatives. They're just
like creeps.
You know, we're all operatives of something.
They're creeps, not operatives. Creeps. Like,
well, you can call it. Yeah, once you are being used to operate and perpetuate, then you can assign language like creeps, assholes.
Let's go to the next one.
You can do it.
Let's go to the next piece. Though.
Anyone, I'm just saying. Satori. This is my point of view.
Okay, look, let's go to the next one. We now got Duggan had his two most solid votes for whatever he wanted to do on city council are both gone now in a haze of corruption. This week, it's Minister Councilman Andre Spivey in a $35,000 scheme, I'm being told, got to do with the towing contracts. Who resigned a couple months ago? The white dude.
Gabe Leland.
Yep. Taking $15,000 and auto parts from a Detroit businessman. Also about towing and property. We go on and on and on. Yeah, there is a super layer. Like, really? $35,000, bro? Like a couple of suits? How could you? See, you're right. The overlay is, I just think society's corrupt. And I've always said corruption can't be done by one person. It takes accomplices, right?
Well, it sounds like there's a lot more to the Spivey thing, because he pled guilty.
And he's been cooperating.
3 years, yeah.
Right? And it's federal monies. Ooh.
It's a big deal.
Now, but having said, we'll go to this. Here's what bothers me, Satori, about the media. They don't have the guts to go first, to do what needs to be done. That's why universally, whatever side the media is on, they're not liked. You know what they like, American citizens like more than the media and Congress? They have more respect for syphilis, colonoscopies,
everything,
and cockroaches. There was actually a poll done.
I believe it.
Okay, so remember last week, the coward cops driveway and everything?
Yeah.
I got, look, The media just stole that shit from us.
Yeah, this video that's running right now.
Yeah, it's running, you know, the drive-by and then the cop drives away.
Yes.
They don't even mention it's us like they did somewhere. You didn't do any work.
Did they ask for it?
Channel 4 asked for it and then pretended like somehow they uncovered it. Nobody linked to that. Hmm. Right?
Well, who is the media, by the way? Because, I mean, were it not for that phone, the video that the young woman took of George Floyd's murder, then what we would do. So what is the media? What's the function it's supposed to serve? And isn't every American citizen the media? You know,
good point.
We can't depend. Once we hear these stories, then what? What are we charged to do about it? I mean, we have to proliferate the story globally and have people.
But here's what we need.
The streets and demand some.
But here's what we need, Satori. That's true. But images and words and talking and podcasts are so ubiquitous. Somebody really needs to dig into the real context. I see it. I know what I saw. But what is the history of this department? What is the funding of this department? Who is this man? We need somebody to do the work and look in Minneapolis. You never even looked in your own police department before this. It's the same here in Detroit. We're not getting a true look at what's going on in the police department. We wait around for video to rip off. You don't ask me for it. You don't know cops on the streets. That's where I got it. They were so pissed off. You pretend like you got it from the chief of police who was trying to keep it under wraps. Mm-hmm. I am sick to death of it. Don't say that courtesy of me, I gave it to you. I didn't. You reconstituted it, ripped it off, and put it on your website. Next time, I'll fucking call you out. I know what you did. Get off your ass and serve the people. It's real hard to do. But that's what you said you were gonna do. You're all playing reporter. Somebody put this, a lot of people put stuff online, but you don't know what you're seeing.
Exactly.
And you don't know if it's true.
But Charlie, you got to understand, too, you have over the years earned a rapport that enables you to receive information and have access that a lot of people don't. But what Satori mentioned is something we've talked about before. Once people have this information that you bring to them or we bring to them or they find out, they have an obligation and a responsibility to act on it, to respond to it, so that we're not continuing to talk about, complain about, and be penalized by the same thing over and over.
That's fair, but again, if people just sit around talking and nobody's gathering up facts that are reliable.
That's true.
And if everybody wants to cover themselves in some political piece of the spectrum, we're going nowhere.
Now we need images. We need video. We need firsthand account, because facts, you know, we already entered into the realm of alternative facts.
Yes.
Where real truths and facts are challenged by lies that are equally considered and acted upon.
I agree.
So but we've been looking at video since Rodney King. Then we had, you know, the follow-up. I mean, we have that. I think it's now, and I do agree, we do have to have something that validates what is said. But then we also need something else other than that, because we're seeing it. You know, how many videos have we seen, you know, Mike Brown, you know, people, but then what happens?
Well,
you know,
we're again, still wait a minute, we're getting off track. Yeah. We're getting off track.
Okay, well,
because we're off track. Again, you're asking for what do we do with it? This is particularly about what the media's role is. That's it starts.
Yeah, what is the media?
There.
What is the media's role? What is the media's role in 21st century?
Let me give you this.
America.
Here's the role. And I've neglected to mention her name, and I want to do it right now. Beth LeBlanc of the Detroit News. She kept on it, mm-hmm. kept on it, and come to find out, the water department knew that thing didn't have power. That's what a journalist is gonna do that the citizen doesn't, not that they don't want to, it's real hard to get to that.
Well, that's what they study for.
So yeah. I wanna give her some kudos there. She's turning into a hitman in this society of art. And we need her.
And I want to go back to what you said earlier. Giving credit is important because what the mainstream media will do will amplify something like the video of the AK being shot out of the car. They will amplify it. But if you don't know where it came from, to Karen's point about how you get it from people on the street, from officers that say, this is messed up, this is not how our department operates or shouldn't operate, that's the story. When it gets amplified by a TV station or something and it looks like it comes from the brass, it looks like they're doing something about it when they might not be.
And then here's the thing. The brass comes out, since nobody really knows what happened there.
Yeah, we looked at that. They turned around and they rendered aid. And I'm
just trying to get rid of it.
I've got the full clip. They drove away for another minute and a half before they even turned around. This is some bullshit.
That's why credit matters.
There was no deputy chief that came across this. This was a shooting. And then they looked at the video that night.
Sources matter.
Everybody in the department knew this.
That's true.
Right?
That's true. And in journalism, you do give credit of information, exactly. Of, you know, graphics, you know, video, whatever, pictures. You are supposed to. Otherwise, it's plagiarism. That's the first. That's a no-no.
And you knew I caught hell because I said, period, talking to a bunch of cops that saw this. I said, it's a coward cop. Now, I'm going to take all the bullshit. And then you can take the video and get your million clicks. Well, you're bullshit. Because the people got to know it. They got to know what's happening with the police. They do. Here's the other one you should do. It's coming. Breaking news. You don't got to do that thing. The rape investigation in the department with the ranking officer with subordinate females. There's a lot to it. It's coming. And there is tangible evidence that officers at the highest level in that department knew 2 years ago this was happening.
2 years?
2 years ago. We'll wait. I'll let the investigation play. I put in my paperwork. We'll see. Nobody gets named. Maybe this isn't true, but it's moving forward. One ought to know this.
It's good.
But yeah. I'll do it. And once it's all cooked and everything, y'all can do it. But I'm sorry. This is what we're all about. Right?
Yes.
All right. Listen, I'm going to talk about Parliament Funkadelic.
Let's do it.
I want to talk about P-Funk. 50-year anniversary of Maggot Brain. That's what it's Satori, you formerly known as Jeanette Magruder, is that right?
That's right.
That's your government name, Jeanette Magruder.
Yeah.
You were a the vocalist, background singer for Parliament Funkadelic.
Yes, I'm one of the Brides of Funkenstein, Never Buy Texas from a Cowboy.
Oh, that's a great record. We're going to play that at the end if that's okay with you. If it's okay with George, because he owns everything.
Great question.
Yeah, owns nothing.
So, look, first of all, just for people that don't know, I mean, this is really sort of a, by way of Jersey, a Detroit invention. What is Parliament? What is Funkadelic? And who are the Brides of Funkenstein? What is that thing for younger people that don't know?
Well, Parliament Funkadelic was one of the biggest black, it was the biggest black rock band in the world in the early 80s. I came on board in 78 with the One Nation tour. So I sang, recorded, and toured with George from 78 through 85. So I'm on everything, Bootsy, anything that came out of United Sound, Super Disc, any of the studios in Detroit. I'm probably on, my voice is probably on that, or at least my hand clapping. Parliament, I mean, if you delve into the history of George Clinton, Parliament Funkadelic, it started out as a singing group, Parliament.
Like doo-wop. Like a doo-wop band, right?
Like a doo-wop band with the whole, you know, pompadour hair, you know, and all of that. But they weren't, yeah, that's Lynn right there. They weren't... They weren't conforming. So the band was called Funkadelic. And then they all just merged together and became Parliament of Funkadelic and actually had two separate labels. Parliament was, when we toured, Parliament was the big stage show with the big costumes, the theatrical production. And Funkadelic was a scaled down version. Same people. We wore the fatigues, Uncle Jam's Army and Parliament Funkadelic. I mean, Parliament was more like the Aqua Boogie. I was one of the Motor Booty ladies. So it was costumes and Larry Legaspi costumes and things like that. So, I mean, George was just, you know, he was a mentor. He was a philosopher, a poet. and you know, for me, I mean, I didn't even meet George. The first time I ever met George or saw George was when he came down on the spaceship on my first gig in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, in front of 10,000 people, you know, because he travels separately from us. The Brides of the Brides of Funkenstein are a spinoff group from Parliament Funkadelic. You know, there I am. So you see me. I'm on the right. Bopping on the right of Lynn.
Looking good.
Bopping. That's Sheila on the other side. Yeah, it was fun. You know, we were wiggling.
So it was like it was like acid rock and heavy guitar and R&B and horns, and it got a disco sound. It had everything. So
had everything. Classical music. Bernie Worrell was trained at Juilliard.
I mean, the songs are going to number one.
I'm classically trained. And there was just your gut bucket, backwoods, Georgia guitar picking, Gary Scheider, Larry Frantangelo on percussion. You just had David Chong, who did Atomic Dog. You had Jessica Cleaves came in. She used to sing with Friends of Distinction and Earth, Wind, and Fire. We had Felipe Wynn that came in at one point, and Sly Stone, who came in at one point to the group to produce and be on stage with us. So it was like, it was funk. It was all these, you know, it was like a pressure cooker of genius.
Watching the, it's on Amazon Prime, Blow the Roof Off. It's a
Tear the Roof Off.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it's
Bobby
COVID.
Brown did the documentary. I'm part of that documentary.
Is it Bobby Brown, like Bobby Brown, Bobby Brown?
No, not Bobby Brown, like Bobby Brown. He lives in Baltimore. He's a white guy. And he used to be on The Wire. He had some minor parts on The Wire, but he wanted to do this documentary. He came in Detroit, and it took him a few years to put together the documentary.
Yeah, and you guys believed it.
I went to the Big Sky Documentary Film Festival when it was first released and was on, you know, a panel at that time.
But you guys spoke for real to Bobby, like the sex and being paid in drugs. Like, what was
it? No, I wasn't paid in drugs. I wasn't paid. I was paid at some point and then no pay. The checks bounced or whatever. But no, we weren't paid in drugs. If we had drugs, we paid for them. Okay.
Yeah,
drugs were everywhere. You know, drugs were just part of that culture, especially of rock and roll musicians. The only people that I didn't see taking drugs that were out on the road at that time with us were Sister Sledge and Kool & the Gang.
No shit.
Really?
So But that whole pressure cooker, genius. And
Yeah. It was just over.
Nuts.
I mean, it was just all of these folks. You didn't have to have a degree. You didn't have to be classically trained. But if you did have a degree and were classically trained, you were there. You just represented black people. It was very black, pro-black. George intentionally said, we're going to do the bass. We want the bass to knock you in your chest, knock you off your feet, because white people are scared of the bass. And so a lot of music was watered down with, you know, pullback bass lines and polite to cater into sort of be palatable for the listening of white people. And he wasn't about that. And, there was a lot of...
And then it turned out white people dug it.
White people did dig it now. I remember we went to Paris and did our show in Paris. And, you know, they didn't speak English and we definitely didn't speak French, but they were grooving. I mean, the language was music and the connection was the funk. And everybody moved to that same on the one beat. And so, it was kind of like going to university of performance, because I got a chance in my early 20s to play Madison Square Gardens, the Pontiac Silver Dome, the Cotton Bowl, L.A. Stadium, 80,000 people. So nothing, no audience under 80,000 would ever intimidate me. I learned so much from George. George said, you perform harder for an audience. Like, we played Atlanta, and they didn't get the word we were coming. Went on the radio in a 5,000-seat venue. The Fox only had 500 people present that day. And so George said, you got to play harder and longer because they showed up, you know. Mm. So I learned a lot of things about performance, about giving to an audience. and definitely about storytelling. They were the funniest people I have ever seen. There were times when our bus broke down, which was the rubber band, and we had to go on the mothership bus. And those guys were so funny. I mean, I haven't met any stand-up, and I'm a stand-up, that could be as funny as Bone and Larry, who played Sir Knows the Void of Funk. But since that time, you know, P-Funk was a great place for me to be. It wasn't a long-term prospect for me, although I was devastated when, you know, the fall of the P-Funk empire happened and we didn't get to do that third album is The Brides. And I...
Let me jump in there.
Yeah.
Listening to you and the other women in the band, you didn't get treated too well. You couldn't be bigger than George Clinton. I mean, The Brides.
No. Don't listen to that documentary, Tear the Roof Off, because if you listen to me, I have only positive things to say.
Well, what happened to The Brides?
We were located in the sexist 80s. We were three women with one female road manager in a vast a band with all men, a lot of men. And then we had Cameo, Gap Band, Cool in the Gang, every male group that you could think of out there. And so there it wasn't treated well as a woman. And as a black woman was not there wasn't even a bar for that. So you had to get the respect that you demanded. And so sometimes P-Funk were our brothers, protectors, allies, and other times they were predators. So you just had to learn how to balance that. I've always operated inside male dominated professions. Stand-up comedy was all men, mostly men. And so P-Funk showed me how to swing hard in certain arenas,
so Tori,
you know, to be fully self-expressed. So don't listen to Tear the Roof Off. If you notice, George wasn't even in that video. And most of the narratives, they were angry about not being paid, in which they have a legitimate right to be.
Yeah, nobody got paid.
So, Tori, to that point in fighting...
I did get paid. Let me correct. I did get paid. We got weekly checks. We finally got to be part of the union, AFTRA, and we had to sign the session sheets, and we got paid, and I still get royalties from Atomic Dog and some other records.
Oh, you're an Atomic Dog. How come no women in the band were inducted in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame with the boys?
I don't know the answer to that question.
Does that make you mad?
I don't know the answer to that question, like, what's the answer to that question?
Does that make you mad? Because there could be no P-Funk without you.
I do know that we were a part of the group, what we lent to the group in terms of our voices and our sound and our bodies and the way we were. I think we should have been afforded that honor. But we weren't. But when you say how come, then you have to look at the where we're located in history and who controls. You know, why aren't more black people nominated, you know, for Academy Awards? You know, why are more women included in? Yeah. So it's a question that goes to always something higher. Something that we can't see that controls and manipulates what happens and what is going on. And until there's a challenge to that, an active challenge to that, ongoing challenge, then you're going to be asking that question.
So, Tori, what do you make of, you know, the artists that will top the charts now, a Cardi B, a Megan Thee Stallion? I mean, is that because you guys fought for what you fought, or is it just natural progression? I mean, what's your opinion on those acts today? And then I find it really interesting, too, that there seems to be a lot of support for Tory Lanez, who shot Megan Thee Stallion. And it just seems like there is still a lot of sexism, at least in that hip hop world.
He didn't shoot her.
Set up. Allegedly.
He didn't shoot her.
Yeah, sexism exists. I mean, when did Me Too happen? Years and years and years and years and years and decades and centuries, you know, Me Too happening. So it's about, and when, you know, we've just started talking about race openly. I'm just now hearing folks on the news outlets use the term white supremacist. Okay, that's a word that wasn't even used before George Floyd. So it's an incremental, frustrating march to change.
Yeah, but here's the thing. Look, here's the thing with the Me Too movement.
It's easy to talk in big, open words. The Me Too movement was very specific about specific things that specific men were doing to women. Mm-hmm. That's how it moves. Mm-hmm. Not big, big white supremacist, because you know what? Nothing's going to change if every person's a white supremacist.
That is a component expression of white male supremacy.
Well, sure. But, you know, like, again, if every time you're talking to a white guy like he's some supremacist, talk to a guy in a trailer.
My turn.
That's not fair. It's not a soapbox. It's a conversation.
If you say
every time some guy downriver don't got a pot to piss in, he's a white supremacist, he got nothing. He has no idea what you're talking about.
Okay, first of all.
Well, I hope he's listening too.
Everybody interprets that as some kind of finger pointing to somebody with white skin that's a man. There are white men who are utterly powerless. You know, I mean, most of the white people out in the United States are utterly powerless. Mm. They don't know it because they are bestowed whiteness.
But they cling to that
like it's going to give them some.
No, but they do know.
Just like Paul was on the show in Grosse Pointe Park. Got flooded. I mean, eventually all of this is going to break under the weight of the inequity of the system.
Exactly.
Because the system is not fair. It's eventually going to be destroyed under its own weight.
That's a great.
I'm just saying, let's deal with it now.
Yep.
Let's talk about it now. I'm not calling any white person a supremacist unless they really are, unless they admit it. And there are a lot of them who are willing to admit it. You know, but we don't recognize racism now because in order to be racist, you have to say some demeaning word to me. You have to burn a cross. There has to be some kind of overt expression of it.
Well, that's usually a good way to judge somebody.
We're actually carrying it within our own bodies.
Yeah, but see, I say that's okay. I didn't want to do this all day, but I'm probably going to judge somebody on their action and then I'll go from there. Otherwise, where in this are we going to find any commonality?
Yeah. Well, the commonality is already there.
That's bullshit.
I mean, when I was doing stand-up, I went out to White Hill or somewhere, Michigan.
White people, you know, Michigan.
White Lake.
I went with the Laugh Riot Dolls. Okay, it was only me and Esther, who was Mexican, and the rest of the women were white. Okay, we drove out. We could smell the cows and the cow dung. We got to this little bar, and we saw the motorcycles and the jalopies, and we went in, and it was all of these artifacts, farm artifacts, you know, taxidermy, and mostly white people with, you know, cowboy hats and stuff. And I'm like, holy shit, I need a glass of wine before I get up here. So I got up, and I said, how many people... Because this was after Wall Street crash. How many people are unemployed? They didn't, you know, nobody said. I said, you're lying bitches. I said, 1 in 4. 1, 2, 3, you ain't got no job. 1, 2, 3, you ain't got no job. They started laughing, then their hands started going up. And then when we started to talk and have the back and forth, their lives were no different than black people's lives.
Speak it.
They wanted the same exact thing as black people
exactly.
wanted. But you think they would, did you think they hugged me? No, because what they had that I don't have is their skin, and it don't make a damn difference.
Maybe they just felt you didn't want to hug them. Who knows?
You're defending them, Charlie.
I'm just trying to love people. Why not? You know, you're foxy. They're foxy, man. A hot chick freaks people out.
Went home, got pulled over by a cop. Uh-huh. I was the designated driver of another woman's car because they both were drunk. And I'm the one that got pulled out the car and had to walk the line. I was so happy that at that time my hormones were out of whack and the cop was so damn cute that I wanted to walk backwards for him and blow into the breathalyzer, you know.
Was he a white guy?
It was a white guy. But I also didn't know at the time that my driver's license was incorrect. It had me as a male, you know.
Oh, my God.
I know. I didn't discover it till somebody said, hey, you know, your license has you as a male. You know, what's up with that? And I looked and for, you know, you mail your driver's license in. So this was going on for 10 years.
I wonder what the cop was thinking.
That's what I'm saying. So when I had a CD that I at the end of the day, he put us back in the car and I said, oh, I have a CD. It was called Menopausal Femme Fatale. He said, just drive. Just
you confused him.
Get out of here. You know?
OK, so speaking of all that, that's a good segue. You want to see our friend, reporter extraordinaire, comedian Detroit Red goes and joins the Trump crowd. He, you know, he's filed a report before. We show that.
All right.
This is brought to you by.
Beautiful.
Thank you. Medicare Guide, which is Medicare is incredibly complicated. When you want to get it, you got questions. Can I keep my doctor?
Does tons papers, of them.
Tons of it. Don't do it alone, man.
Let the experts do it.
Licensed experts.
Yeah.
You can do it in person, on the phone, on Zoom. You go to yourmedicareguide.com and get all your questions answered, right? It's no cost. They'll answer all your questions. You don't pay a dime. Don't go it alone. Let MediGuide be your Medicare guide. Check them out today at, ready, everybody? YourMedicareGuide.com. Get?
Very simple.
Get some help. So, you know, Ms. Shakur.
Yes, sir.
I hope you, you know, the comedian Detroit, you have opened for Joan Rivers. You are a successful comedian. You've had a wonderful life.
I'm having a wonderful life, yes.
I'm jealous of fucking black privilege.
I'm having a wonderful black privilege, wonderful life, and I have earned every fucking bit of it.
And despite all of it, because you're black, it took you twice as many.
I don't know. I have no idea how. I don't know how. I can't measure that.
Okay, you're in show business.
What I can measure is that whatever it is that I envision as an artist, I wanted to see in the 3D world. And so whatever it took to do that, I did that within my system of integrity.
Do you think...
You know, I have had to build things because they didn't exist.
Do you think there's a good-looking people privilege?
Huh?
Do you think there's a good-looking people privilege as well? Like the better looking you are, the easier it is for you?
I think there's pretty privilege.
Yeah.
I think there's pretty privilege, yes.
I do, too.
Yeah.
So yeah. Louis Anderson may be the most accomplished man in comedy.
Funny privilege.
Pretty privilege is only going to carry you to the moment that pretty stops being currency and that something else has to show up, you know?
True enough. Hopefully you'll learn something before you get to that point, right? Okay. Without any further ado, Mark, introduce this part here.
This is Detroit Red, comedian Detroit Red's trip on the Trump train.
Okay, the guy that drives around in that big rig.
He's everywhere, the Trump Unity Bridge, Rob Cortese.
I haven't seen
this. Believe it or not, the Trump train is still rolling. And so is the Trump Unity Bridge float right along with it. So I went with float owner Rob Cortese to a Trump rally to check this shit out.
That was when Trump was the president. You remember when union workers' jobs and the American workers' jobs were protected? You're right again. That was when Trump was the president. America first. The best is yet to come. Trump 2021.
So Rob had me meet him up at his Trump souvenir store so we could ride along to the rally. And believe it or not, I even found some with Biden's name on it. After perusing the Trump souvenir shop, we were finally off to the rally. But with such a smoky start, I started to think this bridge was gonna catch fire before I got to cross it. But fortunately, it was only a flat tire. So after we bridged the gap between his trailer and a spare tire, because he didn't have one, we finally made it to the rally. And I was able to sit and talk with Rob for a minute.
I'm here with Mr. Rob Cortese, the owner of the Trump Unity Bridge that travels and tours around the country and comes to the Trump rallies. How you doing today, Rob?
Not bad. Glad that you're here with us today.
Hey, I thank you for letting us come along with you. I've had fun already.
No problem. It's an interesting day. We pulled out the car stalls out. We got to fix that. Then we get on the road. We get a flat tire on the trailer. And just challenges come
come up before us every day, and we just work to take care of them. We move along because we believe we need to get the message out. Our country is that important, and we believe that the fraud is so thick and so massive, the fraud, that
there's nobody there.
Exposed.
Do you believe that they will overturn this election?
I believe they don't have a choice.
Once it's like four people standing on the highway.
Democrats, why is Gretchen Whitmer fighting so hard to stop them from looking at the ballot, stop from looking at the audit, stop from... You can't have the router. Why was there 30,000 ballots dumped into the Wayne County election in the middle of the night? And why were there dust? Why was there dust all over those boxes? Those were there for a while. You don't get dust overnight from 4 hours or 5 hours driving from a polling station to the audit or to where they've come from.
Now, you know that a Republican overseer was down there said he didn't see a bunch of extra ballots come in. So do you think working against the Trump? He's with the undercover Democrat, or what you think of that?
Well, there was supposed to be an equal amount of Republicans there, and they locked out the Republicans. They had all the Democrats and their people come in early, and they said, oh, COVID, you can't come in. 6 feet, stay back. Oh, stay back. COVID, throw them out. They were removing people because they wanted to see the ballots, and they couldn't get close enough to see the ballots. So it was a sham. It was a shit show. A bunch of bullshit. I know people that were personally there, family members, close friends. I saw the live videos of what happened. I was arrested for a turn signal violation and a crooked license plate. Look at Chief Craig's interview. They asked about why was the Trump mobile arrested and impounded. He goes, I haven't looked into it yet. It was something about a turn signal and a license
plate. Well, now he's running for governor.
Who ever heard of that?
I got a friend.
Has anybody, a Democrat, who do you know that's ever been arrested for that?
Well, you know, in Detroit, we don't arrest people for a lot, but you got to have that turn signal in order. Word association with you right quick. I say a word, you tell me the first thing coming to your mind.
All right.
President Biden.
No such president.
Kamala Harris.
No such fake news.
Well, one thing I learned for sure, after talking to Rob and the rest of the Trumpsters here at the Trump rally today, they surely don't believe that they have a bridge too far to cross to get this election overturned based off of dusty ballot box conspiracy theories, special ballot paper, and overall massive voter fraud.
I'm not sad for me. I'm sad for them. I'm sad for them. Biden's being paraded around like a puppet.
Fuck Biden. Fuck you for voting for him.
Okay, so let me ask you something. Do you believe that Trump won this election?
Yes.
Holding that note, I'm about to get the hell out of here. This comedian Detroit Red, I got to find out who signed away the rights to YMCA and let these people fuck this song up. Deuces!
That was classic. Good job, Red.
I tell you what. Okay, here's my criticisms of it. The fucking background noise is too high.
Loud, yeah.
Okay, let's talk professional. Just a moment. All right.
I'm gonna start now, Charlie.
I'd like that guy to be edited down a little bit.
Rob, yeah.
But
yeah.
I gotta say this. Satori's gonna know this from making art. He's brand spanking new at doing journalism and video, right? And he worked with Sid on this, professional photographer. That's pretty good.
It's good.
Right? And I would watch that. I haven't seen anything that good on local news in a long time.
You're right. I would give you that.
I don't mind.
It's organic.
Yeah.
But it's organic, and that's why it works. I mean, he is just, you know, an average guy who has an interest and now an opportunity to ask someone that he may not ever talk to, and he rolls with it. He's not afraid of people. He's, you know, I mean, that's why it works.
And he's intelligent.
He gave a real shot at the size of the crowd, too, which you don't really see when they cover it on 247.
What crowd?
A lot of tight shots on those.
Oh, you mean making this thing bigger than it is?
You got it.
Uh-huh. So.
But he did the sneak cut to the black lady carrying the Trump flag. He didn't say anything, but I saw what he was doing.
And for all you listening and not watching, he cut to a black lady with a Trump flag. Which is a whole nother special segment of American society. Ugh. All right, look.
I want to thank everybody for coming out to stay with us, Satori. I want to thank you. I want to thank Paul. I want to thank y'all that are listening. Remember, now, 9/11, it's the 20-year anniversary is coming up. I lived it. You lived it. I don't want to forget it. So each week, till September 11th, we're going to offer a little peace. I do want to say this, though. Again, I said it earlier. 20 years in that cesspool of a war in Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. We're going to be pulling out in a month. And already the people that worked with the United States of America, the interpreters, the clerks, the soldiers, there's 20,000 of them stuck there. 200 finally arrived here. Rest of them, they're being hunted down. The Taliban owns the borders now. They're hanging people. They're burning homes. And the State Department says we got a backlog of 2 to 4 years. This is what we did. We did Vietnam again.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
They helped us, man.
I mean, helped us do what?
Well, they helped us. The Afghani, you're talking about the interpreters?
All of it.
Yeah.
What the fuck? But remember, I wonder what the anniversary is going to look like. Look at this mess. But I just want to read a small part of my coverage at that time. You all know I covered New York and Ground Zero. This is brought to you by the bricklayers and allied craft workers, a local too. You want a great job. You want a pension. You want a career. Go to
good benefits.
Bricklayers.org and click join BAC. Look, there's a $2,000 signing bonus, health benefits, and a pension that's not going to get robbed. Apprenticeships are free. Go there. Bricklayers.org and click join BAC. They want you.
Nothing to lose.
Okay. It's just a little piece here. I just picked it. I don't even know if I'm going to set it up. Okay. This is about the workers trying to find the people in the rubble. At some point, all of the workers need a crevice in which to catnap. The ambulance drivers do it in their rigs. The foremen in the construction trailers, the morticians in the morgue. Many go over to St. Paul's Church on Broadway to sleep in the pews. Nearby, on the corner at Fulton Street, laborers stand around waiting to be chosen for office cleaning jobs. Inside the church, the morning coffee is brewing. When you put your head down to rest, you see the back of the pews covered with letters and drawings from children across the country, and you fall asleep reading good things about yourself. The sausage and pancakes are really good, one police officer says. His breakfast is interrupted by a call. More bodies. And at 6:30, in the waning darkness, the seventh victim of the evening is exhumed, and a Port Authority police officer who just carried the body out says to one of the machine operators, "We got some of our guys. The fire department got some of theirs. The city cops got one. Everybody tonight. It's crazy." Except no one spoke of the civilians. Never forget. Karen, I love you. Satori,
love you too. Will you come on my show?
Yeah, but can I go nuts?
Yeah, I help you with your story. You can go nuts within the span of time allotted.
Absolutely.
But I want you to come when we go live at the Wright Museum.
I'd love to.
The Secret Society of Twisted Storytellers. Also, I'm hosting Detroit Performs Live at Mary Grove with Detroit Public Television. And I'll be telling stories at the Concert of Colors. Don Was is celebrating George's 80th birthday with that concert.
And when is this?
Oh, wow. October for Detroit Performs. Probably September for the Secret Society of Twisted Storytellers. I'm not sure when the Concert of Colors airs, but I know they filmed it the beginning of, right after I got back from Jamaica. I went there on July 16th to tape my segments.
Did Jamaica flood?
No. And I'm very proud of Jamaica and the Prime Minister there because they're taking care of their country. I mean, you have to go through some things to get to be let in and to be let out. There are curfews, and I'm glad I went when I went because now the curfews are 8 o'clock Monday through Saturday, and 3 o'clock you have to be in by 3 on Sunday. So I guess that's because of the Delta variant.
Okay. All right. So if people want to know a little bit more about where to find what you're talking about the concerts and thing, where do they go?
You can go to Detroit. I guess you can go to Detroit Public Television to find out about the Concert of Colors, also about Detroit Performs. You can visit our website for all of our activities, and we'll be cross-promoting, which is www.twistedtellers.org, twistedtellers.org. Or you can look me up on my website, SatoriShakur.com. And I thank you so much for inviting me to be here, Charlie. It's a pleasure to meet you and vibe with you. I love you. Your energy is amazing. Karen, is so good to see you. And I'm totally happy about Paul and what he's doing. And thank you, Mark and Big Red. Keep on going, man. Come on out and interview all the tough people. I love you.
All right, you got my number. I can't wait to be on your program. So, again, thanks and happy anniversary to PFA.
Thank you.
All right.
Bye, Satori. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
And this one's for you, Satori.